Okay, so today we will discuss about nonlinear pharmacokinetics. So we will see what is linear and nonlinear pharmacokinetics and detection and causes of nonlinearity. What is Michaelis-Menten equation, which is an equation very commonly used in the to describe the nonlinear kinetics, and estimation of Km and Vmax. These are again terms, Michaelis-Menten constant and the maximum velocity or rate of reaction. We will discuss this, how to estimate these. And yeah, so usually in linear kinetics, what happens is when you are giving a dose of the drug, generally at therapeutic doses, what happens? The change in the amount of drug in the body. Or you can say in other words, the change in plasma concentration of the drug due to absorption, distribution, metabolism, excretion, all this is proportional to the dose, whether administered as a single or as multiple doses. So the rate processes in linear kinetics usually follows first order or linear kinetics. So all the semi-log plots of C versus T for different doses, when corrected for dose administered, they are superimposable. The semi-log plots will be superimposable. Whatever dose you give at different, all will follow the first order kinetics. So the various pharmacokinetic parameters, that is F, the bioavailable dose, Ka, absorption rate constant, Ke, the elimination rate constant, Vd, that is volume of distribution, then renal and hepatic clearance, various pharmacokinetic parameters which describe the time course of the drug in the body will remain unaffected by dose in the case of linear kinetics. In other words, you can say that the linear pharmacokinetics is dose independent, because these pharmacokinetic parameters, they are unaffected by the dose that is given. No matter what the dose given, it will remain the same. On the other hand, in nonlinear kinetics, what happens is that the rate processes of the ADME of the drug depend on carriers or enzymes that are substrate specific and have definite capacities and are susceptible to saturation at a high drug concentration. In such cases, an essentially first order kinetics will transform into a mixture of first order and zero order rate processes. And the pharmacokinetic parameters are changed with the size of the administered drug. So what happens is, after some time, the first order kinetics transforms into a mixture of first order and zero order rate process. So you call it a non-linear kinetics. So what happens in this kind of pharmacokinetics? The pharmacokinetic parameters are changed with the size of the administered dose. What are the different pharmacokinetic parameters? The bioavailable dose, Ka, Ke, Vd, all these change with the size of the administered dose. So you can say that the pharmacokinetics of such drugs are said to be dose dependent. So other terms which are synonymous with nonlinear pharmacokinetics are mixed order pharmacokinetics or capacity limited kinetics. So there are different ways by which you can detect if the pharmacokinetics is nonlinear. First, you can determine the steady state plasma drug concentration at the different doses. So we discussed in linear kinetics, all the plasma drug concentration profiles are superimposable, but not the case here. In another way is by determining some important pharmacokinetic parameters such as bioavailable fraction, elimination half-life, or total systemic clearance at different doses of the drug. So any change in these parameters is indicative to nonlinearity, which are usually constant. So usually these pharmacokinetic parameters are constant, if there is non-linear pharmacokinetics, these parameters change. So there may be non-linearity in the ADME. It may occur in drug absorption or at metabolic distribution, metabolism, excretion. At all of these stages, you can observe this kind of non-linear pharmacokinetics. It is neither first order or zero order. It's a mixed kinetics. Now, what are the reasons for this kind of mixed kinetics? One, when the solubility or dissolution of the drug is rate limited. For example, if they are at high concentrations of griseofulvin in the intestine, it can result in nonlinearity in drug absorption. Usually, griseofulvin is poorly soluble. So when dissolution of the drug is a rate limiting step, naturally, at high concentrations, it will take more time to dissolve that drug. So it is a rate limiting step. So here you can see non-linearity. If you give this drug at high concentrations, if it is at present at high concentrations in the intestine, you can see the in absorption, there is non-linearity. Similarly, if the carrier mediated transport systems are saturated. So when we learned about the mechanisms of absorption, we described the different kinds of mechanisms of transport. We discussed about active transport, passive transport, pore transport, carrier mediated transport. So in carrier mediated transport, what is happening? The carriers are transporting the the drug across. So if those carriers get saturated, then it can no longer transport the drug across. So you can see, as in the case of ascorbic acid, where carriers are used to mediate the transport, if the transport system is saturated, it naturally leads to non-linearity. That means when you see the plasma concentration versus time profile, it is no longer a first order or a zero order reaction. It is non-linear. It is not a first order. First order is a linear kinetic. So it is not no longer first order. When the pre-systemic gut wall or hepatic metabolism attains saturation, as in the case of propranolol, here also you can see non-linearity. So what are the factors or pharmacokinetic parameters that are affected? One is the bioavailable dose, and there is the absorption rate constant. So also the maximum plasma drug concentration and AUC, amount of drug in the body. All these parameters get affected. So usually the first two, that is F and K, they are decreased in the former and two cases we discussed, the first and second case related to griseofulvin ascorbic acid. You can see that the all these parameters are found to decrease, while in the last one, third case of propranolol, you can see that these parameters are increased because of the non-linearity. Similarly, in drug distribution, you can see the non-linearity. It may be one due to the binding of the drug, the binding sites or plasma proteins get saturated. You know, there are plasma proteins have binding sites, site 1, 2, 3, 4, digoxin binding site, like warfarin. Different sites are there. We have discussed it in drug distribution. So when those sites are saturated, naturally, non-linearity is observed, as in the case with phenylbutazone. Similarly, if the tissue binding sites get saturated also, you can observe the non-linearity in the drug distribution. So in both these cases, what happens is that there is an increase seen in the plasma drug concentration, while in the first case, only increase in VD, volume of distribution, is seen. So clearance with high ER gets increased due to saturation of the binding sites. So non-linearity may occur in metabolism due to capacity limited metabolism. Small changes in the dose administered can cause large variations in the plasma drug concentration at steady state, and also large inter-subject variability is seen. Between people, there is variability in these parameters. So two important causes for non-linearity in drug metabolism is, one, when the drug metabolism is capacity limited. For example, the enzymes and the cofactor saturation occurs, as in the case of phenytoin and alcohol. So, you know, enzymes are the bind with the drug to form the enzyme drug complex, and it will, it's a reversible reaction. It also moves the drug across. So similarly, enzyme induction decrease in the causes decrease in the plasma drug concentration, as in the case of carbamazepine. So it is important to know what are the causes of non-linearity in absorption, distribution, metabolism. So auto-induction of enzymes in dose-dependent concentration occurs. Saturations of enzyme, what happens? It decreases the hepatic clearance and increases the steady state drug levels. So these are the things that can lead to non-linearity. So in the case of enzyme induction, the reverse condition is seen. Other reasons include saturation of binding sites, inhibitory effects of metabolites on the action of enzymes. So metabolites start to inhibit the effect of the, or action of the enzyme. This can also lead to non-linear kinetics. Similarly, in excretion, there are different reasons for non-linearity. One, that is the when the active processes, that is active tubular secretion and active tubular absorption, these are the processes happening in the kidney. So when these processes get saturated, for example, active tubular secretion, you can see it in the case of penicillin G, or in active tubular reabsorption, saturation kinetics is seen in use when there you see there are water soluble vitamins and glucose. So saturation of the carrier systems, decrease in renal clearance occurs because of the saturation of the carrier system. So in the active tubular secretion, decrease in renal clearance is seen. But in active tubular reabsorption, you can see that there is increase in renal clearance. What is renal clearance? How much ml of the fluid is cleared of the drug per unit time. Similarly, half-life is also seen to increase. Usually, all these pharmacokinetic parameters of a drug do not change, but under certain conditions, which we described now in the absorption, distribution, metabolism and excretion, mainly due to the saturation of carrier systems, it leads to this kind of non-linearity and change in the pharmacokinetic parameters. So other reasons for in causing non-linearity in drug excretion include factors such as forced diuresis, change in the pH of the urine, nephrotoxicity, saturation of binding sites. In case of biliary excretion, non-linearity is seen due to saturation. Example for tetracycline and indomethacin. So this is a table showing the what are the drugs showing non-linear pharmacokinetic and what are the causes for these. For example, you can see that in the case of absorption from the GIT, if there is saturable transport happening at the gut wall, as in the case of riboflavin or gabapentin, similarly, if there is saturation in the GI decomposition, penicillin and omeprazole, or intestinal metabolism, you can see, as in the case of propranolol and salicylamide. Similarly, for all these drugs, you can see the different causes that lead to non-linearity with the examples is given here. Next, we will discuss about something called the Michaelis-Menten enzyme kinetics. So my Talis-Menten equation is popularly used to describe this kind of nonlinearity. So we know that nonlinear kinetics is also called capacity limited metabolism or capacity limited kinetics or mixed order kinetics. So you can see usually what happens is, and you can see this reaction, the enzyme is combining with the drug to form a enzyme drug complex, and it's a reversible reaction. It may release it as a drug, a product may be formed. Then the enzyme again goes back to react with another substrate. So now if these enzyme sites get saturated, what happens, the drug will be, the amount of drug will start building up. So this is what leads to this kind of saturation kinetics. So there is an equation called the Michaelis-Menten equation, which is best described by, which can describe this kind of kinetics of capacity limited or saturable processes. So you can see the equation is represented in this manner. Change in drug concentration with time, and minus sign indicates that it is a decline. So the rate of decline of drug concentration with time equals the product of Vmax, which is the theoretical maximum rate of the process, and C, which is the plasma drug concentration, divided by Km plus C. So Km is the Michaelis-Menten constant here. So you can see that how does drug concentration decrease with time? It is due to the rate of elimination. So the plasma drug concentration in the body decreases with time due to this kind of elimination. So elimination rate or the rate of decline of drug concentration depends on the maximum rate of the process into C divided by Km plus C. Now you can assume three situations depending on what the value of Km and C are. So it is a rate constant. This Km is the Michaelis constant and C is the plasma drug concentration. So if the Km value of the Michaelis constant is equal to C, imagine a situation, we are going to assume three situations. One in which Km equals C, one in which Km is more than C, and one in which Km is less than C. So all are revolved around this particular equation. So when Km is equal to C, the denominator becomes, instead of Km, we can put C. So C plus C means 2C. So there is a C in the numerator, which will cancel with the C in the denominator. So the equation becomes minus dC by dt equals Vmax divided by 2. So what happens? The rate of the process of the reaction is equal to half of its maximum rate. So instead of happening at the maximum rate, now the rate process or the change in concentration of drug with time becomes half of the maximum rate in this situation when Km equals to C. So in the next equation, we assume that Km is much, much greater than C. In the case when the drug is at low concentration, undergoes saturable biotransformation, this is observed. Now, what happens if Km is much, much greater than C? You see in this particular equation, naturally, if Km is much greater than C, this C term will be negligible. So you can write this equation now as Vmax into C divided by Km minus dC by dt equals Vmax into C divided by Km, because instead of Km plus C, we are just writing the Km term. So that is the second situation. First situation, when Km equals C, the equation becomes minus dC by dt equals Vmax by 2. In the second case, when Km is much, much greater than C, you can assume that Km plus C is just equal to Km, which means this equation now changes to minus dc by dt equals v max into c divided by km. The c term is neglected here. So that is the next equation. So this equation is identical to the one that describes first order elimination of the drug, where v max by km equals to ke, or the rate of elimination. So this this equation is similar to the first order kinetics equation, where you can regard v max by km equals to ke. And we know that we have earlier covered that about linear kinetics and the first order reaction. So that's how it happens. Now, next situation is when Km is much lesser than the plasma drug concentration. So naturally, instead of writing Km plus C in the denominator of equation 1, if Km is negligible, so the equation becomes minus dc by dt equals V max into C divided by C. This Km term is now neglected. So there is a C in the numerator and denominator which will cancel. So the equation becomes d minus dc by dt equals V max. Okay, so we will discuss about the Michaelis-Menten kinetics, which is also called the capacity-limited metabolism or mixed-order kinetics. So here, you can see usually that enzymes react with drugs to give the enzyme-drug complex. And then reversibly, they move back as the enzyme and drug are metabolized. So a product is formed. Now the what happens? The enzyme goes back to react with another substrate to form another molecule of the product. So what happens in this Michaelis-Menten equation is generally used to describe the kinetics of the capacity limited or saturable processes. For example, you see this equation minus dc by dt equals v max into c divided by km plus c. So minus dc by dt is the rate of decline of drug concentration with time, and v max is the theoretical maximum rate of the process, and km is the Michaelis constant. So we can describe three situations depending on the value of km and c. One, when Km equals to C. So in this equation, if you see what is minus dc by dt, rate of decline of drug concentration with time. So as the elimination of the elimination is occurring, you can see that the drug concentration is declining with time, as is seen. So what happens initially, the rate, if you plot an equation of the elimination rate of dc by dt versus concentration, initially it will be a first order kinetic curve, and at low doses then it will intermediate will be a mixed order rate, and at high doses you can see that a zero order rate is followed. This is a plot of the Michaelis-Menten equation. So there is this particular equation which describes this kind of capacity limited kinetics, and we will consider the three situations. First, when Km equals to C, that is the what is the Km, the Michaelis constant, equals to the concentration. So now when Km equals C, naturally in the denominator, the two terms will be C plus C. So naturally, minus dc by dt will be equal to V max. And on top there is one C, down there is two C. So you both the C's cancel. So the equation becomes V minus dc by dt equals V max by 2. If the drug is at low concentration, so that is then if the drug is at low concentration, that is, it undergoes a saturation, biotransformation, and Km is much greater than C. In such a case, you can regard Km much, much greater than C. So in the denominator term of this equation, you, if Km is much greater than C, naturally, what happens? You neglect the C term. And so the equation in this case will become Vmax into C divided by Km. Vmax into C divided by Km. So the above equation is identical to the one that describes first order elimination of the drug, where Vmax by Km equals Ke. So the elimination rate constant term is seen here. So this equation is identical to a first order elimination kinetics, minus where minus dc. So by dt equals Vmax into C by Km. So this Vmax by Km term can be regarded as Ke. So under when Km is much lesser than C, what happens? The same equation, now the previous equation, when Km is much, much lesser than C. So you can neglect this Km term. So minus dc by dt will be equal to Vmax into C divided by C. So cancelling the concentration terms in the numerator and denominator, we get this equation minus dc by dt equals Vmax. So this equation is identical to the one that describes a zero order process. That is, the rate process occurs at constant rate Vmax and is independent of the drug concentration. So here there is no concentration term. So you can say that the change in drug concentration with time depends only on the maximum rate of the reaction, as in the case of an IV infusion process. It does not depend on the concentration term. So we discussed three cases. One, when Km is equal to C, that means Vmax by C divided by 2C will be equal to Vmax by 2. So this will be the rate of the process of reaction will be half of the maximum rate. And in this second case, if the Km is much, much greater than C, naturally, the C term can be neglected. So the equation becomes minus dc by dt equals Vmax into C divided by Km. And in the third case, if Km is regarded to be much, much lesser than C, we can see that the equation Km plus C equals C can be considered as C, because Km is regarded to be much less than C. So this term can be neglected and you can get Vmax into C divided by C, which is again equal to Vmax. So this is the equation for a zero order process. So rate process occurs at a constant rate. The rate is given by the term Vmax and is independent of the drug concentration. So this is the equation or the graph for Vmax by